There has been a market in Bury for as long as anyone can remember, and for a very long time before that. A charter was granted as long ago as 1440 by Henry VI, the then Lord of the Manor, John Pilkington. And from then on, the market was held each Friday, with 2 3-day fairs each year. The site of these markets and fairs would be by the parish church, where the main roads of the town converge, and which even today is known as the marketplace. In 1791, a notice declared that from the 28th of April, the Bury Market would be held on a Thursday. All farmers, butchers, dealers in corn, cheese, etc., are desired to attend, it stated. There not being the least doubt that they will meet with every encouragement they would wish. The traders set out their wares by the walls of the church, and a fish market was centered around the stone cross, which until 1818 stood where the monument to Sir Robert Peel stands today. Here, and in the narrow alleys beyond, known as the Wild, lived most of the town's population. Here were the barber, the butcher, the tailor, the coppersmith. Here, John Shaw produced these paintings beneath the clock, which gave his nickname to posterity. Here, too, William Grant first established his business as a draper, long before his days of prosperity in Ramsbottom. The marketplace at that time was a cluster of coaching inns, hostelries, and alehouses, of which the Globe, known locally as the Two Tubs, still stands today on its original site. From the Eagle and Child, the Old Boar's Head, and the Grey Mare, regular coach services ran to Manchester, Liverpool, Skipton, and Leeds. The early 19th century brought to this corner of Lancashire the full impact of the Industrial Revolution. An ever-increasing number of factories bore witness to the rapid growth of trade, and soon the old marketplace became too congested. In 1839, the Earl of Derby erected a new market on a triangular plot of land, now known as Kay Gardens. But traders were at first reluctant to move from their traditional site, and for a time the building held a company of foot soldiers. The market was regularly held here on Thursdays and Saturdays until the end of the century, when the structure suddenly became unstable and the stallholders were driven onto the pavements. On the 5th of January 1901, Councillor T. Wilson, J.P., using an inscribed silver-plated trowel and mallet produced by local craftsmen, laid the foundation stone of a new market hall. The occasion was later celebrated by a dinner held at the Royal Hotel in Silver Street, when oysters, turbot, lobster, partridge, and pheasant adorned the menu with royal pudding. The new market, designed by Archibald Neal of Leeds, was erected at a cost of £21,134 on a site directly opposite the old Derby Market. The old building remained until 1906, being replaced 2 years later by memorial gardens to John Kay. But the new Edwardian building, with its striking rotunda, stood as one of the town's most famous landmarks for over 67 years. From the early days of the present century, traders brought their produce by horse and cart through the cobble streets, and through the 20s and 30s, the stalls were lit by spluttering gas flares. Through the austerity of the 40s, the Bury Market grew to be one of the largest and most popular in the country. But the 50s brought with them the spirit of change, and the era of Bury's Edwardian Market was drawing to a close. In 1961, plans were published for the development of a new shopping centre in an area known as the Mosses, which had already been cleared of buildings in the early 30s and extended to a network of narrow streets to the north of the site. demolition began at Hall and Nielsen's brakelining works in Turf Street, at a point close to the present-day Minden Parade. Within the next few years, many of the familiar streets of 19th century Bury were to be reduced to rubble. Garden Street, Eden Street, Princes Street. And with them, the Hippodrome and Union Square, where the Whit Friday Walkers sang, and Bury's original black pudding shop near the end of Union Street. Place grew the shape of the future. The new £1.25 million market complex built around one of the most advanced architectural constructions in the country. An audacious structure like an immense bird, its feet firmly rooted deep in Bury's medieval mossland. But in 1968, events took an unexpected turn. When in the early hours of Sunday, November the 17th, a fire started somewhere in the heart of the old market hall, and within an hour the building was gutted. Although fire crews from five towns were called to fight the blaze, the flames raged swiftly through the structure, and the stalls of over 40 traders were rapidly reduced to a mass of twisted metal and smouldering rubble. Yet within hours, a meeting had been called at the town hall to discuss the situation and to consider proposals to get the traders back in business. Empty shops in Princes Street, already waiting for demolition, were reoccupied in time for the Christmas trade, while the ruins of the old market were cleared to make way for a £30,000 temporary structure to house the displaced tenants until the new market was ready. Although it had survived the great heat of the fire, the dome of the old market hall was now supported by a weakened structure, and this once familiar feature of the town skyline was dragged unceremoniously to the ground. The untimely destruction of the old market hall gave added urgency to the project rapidly taking shape a few hundred yards away. By now, the new market hall was well on the way to completion. Over 600 tons of steel and 11,000 tons of concrete had gone into the building, and already it was beginning to reveal the unique nature of its construction. The ribs of the bird wing roof, each weighing 18 tons, spring from a single beam 150 feet long, which runs the length of the main hall. This, in turn, is supported by three columns, which sink 30 feet into the ground and support a total weight of 2,300 tons. Around this is hung a curtain of glass, tinted, to keep out the heat of the sun. But the opening of the new market hall was still some time away, and in the meanwhile, traders had once more returned to their traditional site in the temporary building constructed within the ruins of the old hall. The structure was built in less than 10 weeks and was opened to the public on March the 12th, 1969. Through the summer and through the long winter months, work continued on the new site. By March of the following year, the market hall was complete. But a market is not a market without its cluster of open-air stalls. And so, the hall had to wait through the summer of 1971 while work went ahead on their construction. Meanwhile, traders on the old market had mixed feelings about their impending move.
I've been on the market now for over 40 years, and when I get across there, everybody starts fresh, if you follow what I mean. So in actual fact, it loses the atmosphere, from my point of view, for all the years that I've actually put in here. I may be wrong, I mean, I'm looking forward to it, but I'd be quite happy to stay put.
Every kind, every colour in curtaining. You've no money, you can have them on strap today. Sixpence down, sixpence a week. Get the old man who'll come and live with you while you pay it off, how's that? 10 bob, love. Put 5 yards to the lodger's room, you'll get £1 a week extra off him. He'll never leave you. Any kind, any colour.
That's a china tea set by Hudson and Middleton. That's made in Longton, Stoke-on-Trent. English bone china, sold to me. There's the name on every page. Sutherland Crown China by Hudson and Middleton.
By the early autumn, amidst all the anticipation and anxieties, the new market was complete. On Wednesday, October the 6th, 1971, the new Bury Market was born. Over 350 traders with their fish and their fruit, their cloths and curtains, prints and pots, came fretfully to the promised land. As in years gone by, there were problems. Some had too much and some had too little. Some were pushed in and some were pushed out. Yet despite the protests and the investigations, the market, which for too long had been a project, had now become a living reality. In the months that followed, many of the problems and difficulties that transition must bring were gradually resolved. Soon, traders and townspeople alike began to find their place in the new site, and long-standing traditions of trade were again renewed. Around the hub of the market, where once stood many of the narrow, crowded streets of Victorian Bury, there grew a new area, a precinct in the modern style, free from traffic, where shoppers could move freely along broad parades, sit in the sun or shop under cover. Today, the town is growing and changing, and there are many among these shoppers who will know only the present. But there are those, too, who will have known an older Bury of tram cars and gas lamps, who long again to see the great Edwardian dome towering over Kay Gardens, and perhaps doubt the wisdom of change. But so it has been through the many generations since the time when John Pilkington, by royal charter, began the first regular weekly market in Bury over 500 years ago.
Sunday, the newly installed Mayor of Bury, Councillor William Kirkman, accompanied by the Deputy Mayor, Alderman Ernest Cocaine, the Town Clerk, Mr. J. A. MacDonald, and other civic dignitaries from Bury and surrounding towns, walk in procession from the Town Hall to the Parish Church for the annual civic service. Proceeding by way of Knowsley Street, Haymarket Street and Market Street, the Mayor, on arriving at the church, is greeted by the Rector of Bury, the Reverend J.R. Smith. Local authorities and organisations were well represented, filling the beautiful church with colour. Time passes. Sir Robert Peel, perhaps our most famous son, looks down at the scene, at the many residents of Bury who wait for the mayor and his retinue to emerge from the church and take part in the march past and salute. Thank you. After the march past, the mayor, accompanied by the rector, returns in procession to the town hall. Market Hall develops, the Old Boar's Head, undergoing reconstruction for the Halifax Building Society, collapses. Tragedy was prevented by a builder's signboard under which 60-year-old Charles Bontoft of Broad Oak Lane lay trapped. Workmen, policemen, ambulance personnel and passers-by rescued him, and by all accounts it was a miracle he survived. The Norcosel works at Nangrees, and once again our scoop cameraman Bob Orrell was there to record on film the fire which gutted the works before the flames were brought under control. The precision job was carried out by experts when the tetrashill chimney was demolished. Another fire, this time at the Ferdeal Construction Company, once more puts Walmsley in the news. Damage was estimated at £6,000. Buildings and a water main in the rock were damaged by an explosion, which was thought to have been caused by an accumulation of leaking gases. The culmination of the bicentenary of St John's Church, the vicar, the Reverend Arthur Hulse, officiated at the rededication service, at which the celebrant and preacher was the Right Reverend Kenneth V. Ramsay, Bishop of Hume. The church has seen many changes since the Reverend the Honourable John Stanley gave land in 1770 for the building of a chapel of ease dedicated to St John. In 1862, because of the growth of the congregation and the importance of the chapel, it became a parish church. The very climate took its toll of the fabric of this church, and this, and the fact that many parishioners had moved to other parts of the parish, made it necessary to build a new church. The Earl of Derby gave a plot of land at Seedfield for this purpose, and in February 1914 a temporary mission was opened. So it was that from 1914 to 1964 the parish of St John had in effect two churches and two congregations. The old church was closed in 1964, mainly through deterioration, but also because the cost of maintaining two churches was putting too great a strain on the parish finances. The appeal for funds for a new church began in 1957, and 2 years later, construction went ahead until, in 1964, the new St. John's Church was consecrated by the Bishop of Manchester, Dr. William Greer. View the newly built Senior Pupil Centre while attending an old-time fair at the Derby School, noted for its success in money-making ventures. This venture was no exception, and the money will go towards the building and the furnishing costs of the centre. Lord Derby paid a brief visit to the fair and seemed to enjoy the old-time atmosphere created by pupils in 19th-century dress, displays of vintage cars and other forms of transport, steam engines and a very old merengue steam organ made in Paris. Handicrafts, gems and preserves, all made by the pupils themselves, were on sale on some of the stalls, and trade was brisk. The fair was brought to a memorable close when a detachment of the 1st Battalion, the Royal Regiment of Fusiliers, beat the retreat. Television brought the election results into thousands of homes at the culmination of a campaign which more or less began with the visits of Edward Heath and Barbara Castle to the constituency of Bury and Radcliffe. Conservative and Labour campaign organisers worked at fever pitch, and the two candidates, Michael Fidler and Dennis Hunt, travelled all over the constituency addressing their supporters at numerous meetings. On polling day, the 56 booths were in action from 7 a.m. and officials reported steady polling during the day with a main rush in the evening. The result was announced at 12:35 a.m, slightly earlier than expected. We'll be right back.
cast at this election are as follows. Fiddler Michael, 29,796. Hunt Dennis Victor, 26,000. The democratic opportunity to express where their preference lies.
What I would like to say tonight is that I am proud to be a member of the Labour Party and to support the Labour government.
Cameraman in London is Martin Smith, who, after 2 years at the London School of Film Technique, has become a trainee editor with the BBC at Ealing. He was on the spot when the Berry Merrill car appeared in the busy traffic approaching Buckingham Palace. The occasion was a royal garden party, to which Mr. Alan Childs, principal of the Berry School of Arts and Crafts, together with his wife and daughter, had been invited.
Short time ago in the car park near Kay Gardens was a thriving market. One of the earliest achievements of the new development was the construction of the southerly bypass from Market Street to Rochdale Road. It was decided that the road should be known as Angoulême Way in recognition of Berry's twin town in France. Appropriately, the road was officially opened on June the 29th, 1971, by the mayor of Angoulême, Maître Roland Chiron, resplendent in a cummerbund of the national colours. With him at the ceremony was the then mayor of Berry, Councillor J. Skellern. Meanwhile, to the north of the town, work was well in hand on the construction of another section of the Inner Ring Road, linking Bolton Street with Moorgate. The road was opened in September of 1971, and as its route lay close to the site where one of Berry's most famous families established their business, it is named appropriately Peel Way. By the close of 1972, many familiar buildings in the area around Tenterden Street had been demolished to make way for a new roundabout and the final link of the Inner Ring Road. When completed, the scheme should relieve much of the congestion caused by two major roads passing through the centre of the town. Midsummer brought victory at Westminster for local MP Mr. Michael Fiddler, who, after a determined and courageous battle against the proposals of the local government bill, successfully brought an amendment which finally destroyed the proposed Berry-Rochdale merger. From April 1974, Bury will become the leading town in a district authority with a population of 180,000 people, which will include Ratcliffe, Prestwich, Whitefield, Tottington and a part of Rumsbottom. The district will form part of the Greater Manchester Metropolitan County. One man died and another was injured when fire destroyed a warehouse belonging to David Hall and Sons, local haulage contractors, in July. Brigades from Bury and five neighbouring towns prevented flames from spreading to nearby factories, but Mr. Robert Chapman, a voluntary fireman from Rumsbottom, was overcome by fumes and later died in hospital. Warehouse situated in Woodhill Road, Elton, was completely gutted and several of the company's lorries and trailers were destroyed. At the new headquarters of Castlecroft, members of the East Lancashire Railway Preservation Society are busy building up a comprehensive transport museum, and on October the 1st they were presented with two new additions to their stock, a Planet 040 diesel locomotive, until recently in the service of National Benzo, and a 1914 Lancashire and Yorkshire goods van, donated by Spillers Limited. Steam is still the attraction, though for the present the journeys of their resident 060 locomotive are somewhat restricted. Situated only 200 yards from Bolton Street Station, where the original East Lancashire Railway set up its headquarters in 1846, the Society plans to reopen the Bury-Rottenstall line closed by British Railways earlier in the year. Negotiations are already well advanced, and with the help of the local transport authority, it is hoped to begin operations by May of 1973. Meanwhile, on the site of the old Knowsley Street station, the annual September Fair brought the summer to a close. ¶¶ Will the Farwell itself be seeking a new home next year, for the site is scheduled for development as a linear park, and later as the centre of a new road-rail interchange, when communication, integration and expansion become an essential part of the Bury of the 70s.